OpenStreetMap is the largest open map in the world and is created by volunteers. The good way to think of OpenStreetMap is to really develop maps. This particular screenshot is my neighborhood in South Bangalore. There is a temple I visited in the mother. I go for a long walk on the right. My brothers and Gabbar were in meetings. A couple of things were happening a couple of years ago, and still, volunteer mappers out of the world have their work with things that are missing there, like highways, buildings, parks, and things. Every year, there is this conference called State Map, which brings volunteer mappers from around the world to one place. This from 2016 happened in Brussels, Belgium, where lots of volunteers of the OpenStreetMap project came together and discussed how to have fun and get to do a lot of planning. The heartbeat of the project is just like we have X-Meters kind of engineering programs, X, etc. There are specialized meters for any map. This one is called A, the others are just abstract, etc. Basically, what we need to select a feature on the map, there is one of the properties of the region. What's the name? What's the address? Where is the name? And then we can do what they want, take it together, and then we save. And as an assistant, the slide is the map of all the regions. kind of focus and add on just a subset that are kind of potentially problematic and really want to scale human input. The first project I'd like to talk about is Wisdom Content. This is an open project on GitHub. Mapbox, GitHub.com, Mapbox, and Wisdom Content. The idea here is to take some knowledge of the real world and convert it into small binary functions. And then when something happens, these functions flag. So let me give a couple of examples. First is a very large variable. You all know from the real world that variables are some area in size, generally. And I say there's this very JPEG level that covers all of JPEG. That looks like a normal way. It's not something that is common to happen. So this is one kind of knowledge that we have about the real world. Buildings cannot be covering the same objective, which we translate to small functions or compare functions. And once it's compare function for the building is here. What we do is given a feature, check if that feature is a building on the last line. And then calculate what's the area here. In this case, the hardcoded value is 1 square meter. So if the area of building is 4 square meter, plan for that area. Because that's something that we don't expect to have in the neighborhood. Another example is invalid highway land. Highways can be, say, a primary highway, tertiary highway, or a stop. But it cannot be a building. So a building is an invalid value. Similarly, we have a list of tags, like T value pairs for a highway. T the highway, values can be motorway, primary, tertiary, etc. And then whenever a new value comes up on the OpenStreetMap topic that is not part of this list, flagging this. So we can say this is not valid value. What's work in this rule-based system is that they're simple to identify. Like they're very small, modular, so very simple to identify. In the process of writing lots of compare functions, they lots of domain expertise on OpenStreetMap project itself. What are the different features? How are they mapped? What is the dimension? How the properties look like? How the geometries look like? Then lots of team members who are doing programming and shipped a lot of production code in this process because this was kind of a great way to start programming. What's common? But so great is the way you should use. They can take a very fast thing and say, when you say 1 square kilometer is allowed, should it be 5 square kilometers? Should it be fast? How do you design? The kind of way you should use it now. And then there are an infinite number of possibilities on which we have how we can scale more long or more right? Because this again is the generic feedback that we have. This brings me to our machine learning experiments to kind of try to find a solution to such a validation problem using techniques of machine learning. I kind of really like this talk to Josh Prince. He kind of says there are two kinds of data scientists. One in the lab, the other in the factory. I'm definitely in fact a data scientist, software engineer, from case to ground, and we say all. He says that this machine learning project comes up, and we are next very good as much machine learning as required to solve this problem. Machine learning, we need to study that gives computers the ability to the code to explicitly program. I kind of really like this. The compare function I showed you previously, you might explicitly program this big thing. This is an invalid map. And now, can machine learning, like, can the machine learn even lots of data from the map? Like, this goes through this computation part. The data that it has is all that is kind of log, geometries, the properties, the labels, the interpreters, the comments, and the user. for machine learning based solution. That given a feature can be kind of any linear model that predicts whether that is a good model.
Gabbar
is one such experiment that we have been working on for the last few years. It's a machine learning library with both Python and JavaScript. Open up in the Mapbox and Open. Scratch experiment and so basically, there are two architectures here. One, the offline, the other is the offline architecture. The offline architecture is there in the lessons, the training, testing, validation lessons. Jupyter notebooks are kind of easily used as part of the workflow to kind of use these data sets, train the model, evaluate it, the kind of integrated. CLS, tough models for data into production. And in the online architecture, OpenStreetMap as a project releases many changes. Like whatever happened in the last bit gets released in 1.5. And that is what we have listened. These are the changes that happened in the last bit converted to JSON, which is easier to run the process and make scripts. And then extract all the attributes that the models can do. Use the CLS one in data annotations. Where there are those things kind of concept. The data sets, the flows. This is a work that Mapbox has been doing for close to 1 year. And this has resulted in this whole amount of 19,000 plus. Labeled data sets. And this is totally unique in the OpenStreetMap project. This is taken close to a year now, but it's a good time basically. What I'm saying is, for there are totally 90,000 chain sets that users have looked at the features of the chain set for properties, geometries, etc. And then labeled them as this looks good or this looks suspicious. And then they are suspicious. A feature would look something like this. The before question of the feature doesn't have a name, the user needs to add a name to the input and the name objects. So this is a common change in OpenStreetMap, adding a name to an existing feature. This is a name JSON. And then there's user details. Who is the user? How many days has to be spent on OpenStreetMap? How many chain sets does it have? How many features does it have? Basically, all these data sets reflect 19 approaches and the two broad machine learning, supervised learning and supervised learning, to walk along the following system. With supervised learning, you kind of know what the analysis looks like. So, we have this number of 90,000 labeled gene sets. And that is the data set. Each data set, each kind of sample has this group, this is not. Want the model to kind of learn how to do this so that we can do a part of your online case. This is where the challenge is limited by the data set. But it's kind of nice because we know what the data set is. The unsupervised learning, you take this giant dump of data of OpenStreetMap and you want to kind of realize it yourself. Here, we don't want to tell whether something is good or bad, but in our case, give all highways that are the same word, both geographies and properties. It kind of looks like all these highways and says, among all these, 99% of these look very similar. This 1% looks a little different. It's not saying it's wrong, it's saying it's different. So, the supervisor, that's something that we can do. So, the current state of Gabbar is the initial version of it is kind of deployed for production right now. What it's doing is, as and when new highways are created in the OpenStreetMap project, it reviews it for both properties and geometries, extracts the features, sends it to the training model, extracts predictions from the model, whether it's kind of a good or a bad, or what kind of has to be. then bounce back and send on this job. Just say for a new group of users. The label that you can use flag label. This case has been a flag label for the there's also an experiment in Google that given the chain set ID, it lists the features that are kind of used for the right model for that ID cluster. So then you are approaching the insights that kind of had this ability cover. The first something we want, what are the performance of scaling sets? If you all know more than you have had, the better the performance of one is. So it's kind of nice to see this and generally going on words. And you also see it's not flat, so it is kind of an opportunity to add more data and data. And to take it a better model in terms of numbers. Modern and the parameter, say for instance, how we should be distributed, how many flows should we have. These are hyperparameters. Usually these hyperparameters are these kind of real. We saw a good pair of n plus plus performance improvement, n plus percentage. Then we kind of tune these like particular parameters. On the left is before the parameters were removed and on the right, what kind of comes up and you start doing this kind of thing. Part of the workflow was efficient maintenance. Basically, we want numbers of the diagonal as high as possible, and numbers of the empty diagonal as low as possible. What the workflow is as and when new models are kind of trained, each model we take a couple of samples of it and then train what is the model learning, what is the model model. This has been kind of very different. Something very common in the empty space is back of words, which kind of works great for uniform text. But with OpenStreetMap and other structured data, there's no kind of uniform text as such to use. Take the value of this. So we modify the battle tag, words once the battle tags. Basically, each tag is sent from the world. This example is that this is feature, the version 3 of the feature doesn't have a name, so it has a 0 name. And then the version 4 is a name, has a name, so we're not including the answer for the language. You see, you can see how the samples kind of affect the model performance. This is one particular use case where there were five features that were very similar, and one of it was labeled kind of bad, and the other four were labeled good. And for some reason, the model was always saying these four are bad too. And that was kind of interesting. These were manually labeled as thumbs up, but the model was saying thumbs up. But because there was one sample that was kind of bad, the model was trying to push for the badness of that particular region. Now, the thing is kind of great, we've kind of learning a lot of things in the process. So the first is, there are a variety of features on the screen. There are tendons, highways, paths, residential yields, etc. Each feature has properties of its own. Like for a temple to have OPRs, where is it located? What's the address? A highway can have what's the speed limit? Is it a one way? What are the current restrictions on it? Parts, residential highways, they're not there yet where you can have a generic classifier that can classify any feature and whether that features that a good feature or something wrong. There will be model performance versus attributes, like you measure the performance of the model as and when you add more attributes to the model. And it's kind of seen some other cases that you don't understand where the model performance and the attributes and kind of one way to do what is happening there. So, we were kind of the biggest learning for me personally the last 3 months working on this project from a case where when you talk about social learning to something in production, yeah, it's an experiment in our production, but still, so that's machine learning is hard, but it's kind of possible. with OpenStreetMap package, everybody can use as shared files of their own. And then we'll do these techniques and take a shot. Some of the resources that have been helpful for me is Opera Books, Jasmine, Corsair. This free book, I think data science network by Jake Mann, that's coming from the semiconductor documentation.
If you have a question, raise your hand and we'll bring a mic over.
Hello. So I work for a company called Here, which also makes maps. And I do a lot of projects like the one you mentioned internally. So we also have been struggling with a lot of machine learning models for validation. We need really high accuracy because our maps are primarily used for navigation, so error rates need to be like 0.1% or lower. Now the problem is that when you talk about unsupervised learning, we also actually had hope that looking at our there's a plethora of data we have in our stores, and we intended to find lot of some anomalies which can guide us. But it was really hard. So I would like to know, like, so you actually mentioned classific confusion matrix and all that, but where can I get some resource about the unsupervised or anomaly detection methods you used, or what kind of features were there, things like that. In our case, just to give an example, just for the signpost, we have 187 different types of signposts. So you can imagine like the kind of data we had. We expected that we'd find some signals, but at least so far we have not. So
basically, this project part of feature engineering, one main part of the logos. So we find the repository from Mapbox. Basically, unsupervised learning, we're using anomaly detection as a approach to get brain to understand.
Hi, great talk. Thanks a lot for the talk. My question is, how do you merge supervised and unsupervised learning in particular in your domain, right? Because suppose you find an anomaly using unsupervised learning, then do you apply supervised learning on that, or is it like they're just separate systems and you're trying to figure out which one works best and which one doesn't?
I think there are kind of use cases for part of our machine learning, but the advantage with supervised learning is we know what we are expecting. But there we kind of limited to what we have already known. There are some new ways of bringing the map that we kind of don't know about. And that's something we want to kind of explore with the supervised learning. It's not practically possible to kind of look at all the ways that the map could play and stuff. So we kind of go to that area and see what's different. And then try to see that difference is very the map.
Hi, Ravi Mutnuru from Capital Flow. Great talk, thanks. My question is, do you monetize this service? If yes, could you explain how the business model works? Do you monetize these services? When it looks like you guys put a lot of effort into this, do you just give it as a free service, or do you actually monetize these services?
OpenStreetMap is kind of an open project. Take Mapbox and takes all the data for these maps. Like all the apps that put on Mapbox maps, in fact, are using data from the street. One of our attempts with Gabbar is build very good anomaly if there's an open machine learning project or an open learning project. So that's something we're trying to do. The APIs are very good, like we have a straight machine learning. And also the resources of how we can then create the model for the physics that's also shared on the process. Including the latest models. The data sets are also kind of nice. So if somebody is kind of interested to download these data sets, play around there is a modeling. The modelization, I think, for us is comes for the map. Like, the maps are great, that's the thing for Mapbox. So, I think that is the thing that we are doing. I think the tools and stuff like, are the way to be part of the company. The project has more than this.
Hey, thank you for the talk. My name is Shubham, I'm from Microsoft. So it's like one of the slides you pointed out, like insights, which is the model which we built, the machine learning. So I want to know about, like, sometimes we follow insights, but the model which we built based on the insights does not give us the best results. So for the solving one problem, we have two approaches. Let's someone say that this features would work out, someone say these features would work. So how do you generally judge on the basis of insights, like, or where you do get the decision on the that which insights would give the better result? Is it just the experience based, or it also has something algorithm on top of the insights which actually take the decision which insights you should go with? This, because insights are always not always the best way to go. In my practical case only, the insights were not giving the better results. So we trained two models, then saw which were. So what is the approach in this case? Is it should always go with the models or experience based, or I mean just
yeah, the main expertise has to be very limited. The main expertise kind of gaining good resistance has to be kind of gaining important cognitive position that you want. So I would say from the supervisor that he has to do the experience. But what we want is supervisors. And we like to take a lessons approach where we kind of find things that are different and then we see that the difference is in the map. So there's a lot of like taking this kind of process where you guys can take the best number of best things. Fast relation.
Thank you. You mentioned about the anomaly detection, that are you using any time series component, like which models you use, like the IMA models and things like that. So which one do you use? And for the model selection, do you use any AutoML kind of feature? How do you decide that the best model? Are you using the AutoML or it is a manual process?
No, that's a series component as such. We're using something called distillation for us.
I have a modest question. Can we use unsupervised information for supervised learning?
Yes, right. The connection is because with supervised learning, we are always kind of limited by what we already know. We kind of want to know what are the other ways that this would work. Or maybe sometime in the future, we want to gain the learnings from unsupervised learning.
You can definitely tell it's the second day of the conference because everybody's bolted off to lunch. We have time for one more question. And then the rest of you can bolt off to lunch, and the line should be a little shorter.
Thanks for the talk. My name is Ayush. So the question is that do you only review the ones which are flagged by the Gabbar? Because then you need to believe your algorithm that it's pretty good when it is saying good. And what are the algorithms that you are using? Some particular ones, if you name.
So basically, the first category has been good. Machine learning is still very experimental. So what's kind of learning category is the new racism connection where ingredients and the number close to 70 plus these new racism from the central flag subset of these ingredients of animal close to SNL. From the models that I can come up is very random for us.
more to do with, like, which I also faced in my company, that if you have labels which are not flagged, how do you know that those are correct? So it's like, if they are flagged to be wrong, you know that they are wrong. But if they are not flagged, you cannot assume that they are not wrong. So yeah, so this is a problem, and I would say that, you know, you should explore things like you know, one class classification and stuff like that. So
Have you tried using an artificially created or pseudo data set to test your models? Maybe that's one way of refining and tuning your model. And if so, in this math case, how difficult or easy is it to generate fake data points?
Thank you all so much for your attention. Thank you.